Third Eye Drops are intended for open-minded adults. Now administering Third Eye Drops.
Greetings, godlings. This is your friend Michael Phillip, and I am ecstatic that you've decided to once again plug your consciousness into the conversational coven that is the Third Eye Drops show. Every week, I find myself in this ridiculous position of trying to distill these long-form, organic, interdisciplinary rap sessions into an introductory rant at the top of the show. And it is definitely an excruciating endeavor, not only because listening back to yourself pontificating is awful to any rational person, but because my lovely guests drench me with so much excellence and so many wonderful ideas that I end up with an embarrassment of riches. I've got way too much goodness to distill down into a brief rant. Trying to do it is like, it's like psychic burpees or something. But this week, I have got it, my friends, because when I look at both Dennis McKenna and Bruce Damer, the answer is right there, glowing in giant, bold, neon letters. Because what I find most admirable about them, among their many accomplishments and fascinating features, is their bold rejection of permission. These are men who have accomplished a tremendous amount on their own terms. We all know how hard that is. Every step of the way, society has a hierarchy and a new hoop to jump through and a new game to play. And you've got to play that game to some extent. That's what makes nonconformity and originality and success almost impossible. You got to figure out a way to invert or reappropriate those constructs on your own terms. And both Dennis and Bruce were brilliant enough and brave enough and tenacious enough to do it. If you're familiar with them, you already know. If not, you will hear exactly what I am referring to in the coming words that comprise this chat. But anyway, Dennis McKenna is a scientist, an ethnopharmacologist to be exact. He is a researcher, a lecturer, and an author. He's really a trailblazer. He has spent decades doing both academic lab work and personal heavy lifting with psychedelic substances. He's also the author of Brotherhood of the Screaming Abyss, a memoir about his adventures with his brother, the late great bard of psychedelia, Terence McKenna. Then, of course, we've got Dr. Bruce Damer, who, in addition to being part of the same thought and human enclave as Dennis and Terence McKenna, Dr. Bruce Damer is currently a researcher at UC Santa Cruz, where he is working on a theory regarding the origin of life. He has also worked on projects for NASA, developing concepts for asteroid-capturing spacecraft and other really amazing things. And he's got a great theory on how to get to and return from Mars safely. Extraordinarily fascinating stuff. Definitely recommend that you check out his TED Talks. So needless to say, it was my absolute pleasure to speak to both of these gentlemen again. I actually spoke with them on my previous show. If you want to check that out, check out Midwest Real. But speaking to them together at the same time was truly a delicious drink of psychic conversational Kool-Aid. And good God, do we go everywhere in this thing. But before we hike our way up Conversation Mountain with Dennis and Bruce, allow me to temper your excitement with some reminders on how you can support this fledgling media vessel. It really shouldn't destroy your excitement that much, though, because it is pretty goddamn simple. You guys all know how the internet works. All you have to do is go to thirdeyedrops.com and choose a way to trickle a little altruism our way. You can accomplish that via a donation by shopping through our Amazon link, which, let's get real, brothers and sisters, my fantastic fellas and females, you are going to shop there anyway, so why not do so through our Amazon portal, which will also give us a small kickback of whatever you decide to purchase. Other than that, we are just baby stepping here still, my friends. This is only episode 5. We are still inside the first month of this thing's existence, so we still need your subscriptions and reviews on iTunes big time. And it really is the best way to go anyway, because then you will know the moment a new show pushes itself out to the masses, or what I hope will one day be the masses. But we are off to a deliciously strong start. We debuted in the top 10 in the iTunes philosophy category. We've got thousands of downloads and hundreds of subscribers already, but this thing is nowhere near where I know it can be. So please help us out with your reviews and subscriptions on iTunes or whatever service you listen to this thing through, whether it be Stitcher or some other thing I did not sign up for. I did sign up for Stitcher. Stitcher is wonderful, but I have also noticed this thing popping up on a number of other outlets that who knows how it got there. You can also come hang out with yours truly on the usual social media suspects, Facebook, Twitter. I welcome any and all weird little musings you may want to share. We also have a Third Eye Drops Facebook group. We all know how weird the Facebook algorithm is for pages and content sharing, but groups seem to be slightly better. So jump on the Third Eye Drops Facebook group with me and a few hundred other weird, wonderful, lovely, intelligent human beings, FBI agents, and whatever other consciousness vessels have figured out how to make Facebook profiles and join Facebook groups and post on Facebook.
Begin symbiosis.
How's my volume level?
You sound good, Bruce.
Okay.
Sound wonderful. You definitely have the best headwear among us.
It's an Andean wool cap. It helps in the winter.
Yeah, yeah. I thought the idea of getting the two of you guys together was just a really entertaining one because, you know, you guys go back quite a ways. You've both had extremely wild, unconventional, interesting lives. And I you know, talking to you guys individually was a great time. And there are some great stories and great topics. But I couldn't help but think getting the two of you together would make it even all the more interesting. And there's got to be so many, you know, occasions and topics and whatever. But I guess we can just start with, how did you two guys initially meet?
Well, I think the connection, of course, was really through Terence, you know, and Terence and Bruce knew each other pretty well or got to know each other in the latter part of the 90s. And so when Terence was ill and when he was out in Hawaii, Bruce was out there. And I guess you guys were doing several different kind of events and multimedia stuff and all sorts of things. And that's how the connection was made. But we really didn't make our connection, not really our personal connection, until quite a bit later. In fact, it was in 2012, I think, that we made the really kind of personal connection. And that's when Bruce was doing this retrospective on Terence at Esalen. I was working on the initial first draft of my book. He asked me to give him some material from that he could read at Esalen. He did. My relatives, my ex-sister-in-law, my nephew, and all that went completely ballistic for no reason that I can tell, but they did. And so in a sense, Bruce and I were kind of like, you know, we were like huddling to the cave trying to keep out of this shit that was flying around. And so we certainly bonded over that. I mean, I guess we, you know, deserve equal blame or credit, however you want to see it, for that. But wouldn't you say, Bruce, that was kind of that was certainly a pivotal event in our relationship in any way?
Yeah, I think it was a sort of a forging thing, because, you know, it's beyond words. It was some kind of a deep psychic forging that happened. And I think it, you know, both for both of us, for me personally, it was a really deep desire to go in to where I felt I felt Terence, where Terence's soul was, and really trying to release that, release him from whatever bardo he was in. I just felt deeply moved about that. And I believe you did too, Dennis. And any kind of major psychic, you know, digging out and releasing has its consequences. It has a blast effect, maybe, that's not interpreted in the way that you had done it, with goodness and love and care and concern. But it was a forging kind of a thing.
So the drama was over just the emotion of this speech, or what was it exactly?
Well, you know, I don't know. I mean, I'm still baffled by it, frankly. But it was essentially that, you know, what I gave Bruce was a section, a chapter from the first draft that described, among other things, a period of Terence's life when he was clearly undergoing a spiritual crisis and maybe beginning to question his whole, you know, ontology, his devotion to psychedelics, his, you know, his public persona. I mean, he was conflicted. He had issues at that time, and I wrote about them, and I shared that with Bruce, and I, you know, and apparently this was somehow considered off limits, you know, by Kat and by, you know, his kids. Although I don't think there was any, you know, if anyone appointed them to be the arbiters of what I could write about, I failed to get that memo. But you know, in an effort to respect their wishes, you know, after this sort of big, you know, conflict, this big blowout, then when the book was being, you know, further revised, because like I say, it was a first draft, and, you know, I welcome their input to, you know, suggestions and so on as to what I should take out of. And they had a whole many ideas about what I should take out. I mean, it started with don't write it at all, you know, but, you know, that was not acceptable. So I did take quite a bit. I toned down a lot of things in the book that were maybe too personal in their view, you know, but it really didn't heal, you know, anything. It didn't really make a difference in the end, and which was disappointing to me. But, you know, I should have realized, I should have known it wasn't really about that at all. It was, who knows what it was about. Families, what can you say? You know, families are dysfunctional. There are deep-seated resentments and you know, history, you know, all that in all families, I suppose. So I dredged some of those things up. And Bruce is, you know, to blame for all that, or, you know, only in that he was the catalyst. You know, he was the one that asked for this stuff. And at the time, I didn't see any problem with giving him some.
So it was a proverbial killing of the messenger on that one.
Essentially, yeah.
You got probably the brunt of some emotion you weren't expecting, but
yeah.
It's, you know, here's the interesting thing. The meeting at Esalen, which was deeply felt by everyone, we really felt we had done a beautiful thing, and people were in tears.
Mm-hmm.
On Monday, we actually felt Terence's presence come in. We rearranged the we were in the big yurt, which is a lot of the time where Terence did his talks. Mm-hmm. We rearranged ourselves into a circle, and we opened up a seat and put a kind of a very beautiful tryptamine inflected piece of art on one empty chair, and we invited Terence to join our circle. And by golly, everybody felt him come in.
Wow.
A great sense of relief that we had told this truth, and we had really kind of, as a community, we now brought him back. We basically said, you know, Terence, we love you. We know what happened. We know what you went through. We love you. We're not under your spell in that way. And you belong to us, and please join us. And then after that, a whole bunch of us went out to the lawn in front of the big house. There's this particular spot under a tree where Terence would always lie there and smoke. And everybody,
the smoky tree,
and everyone laid down one after the other and took a puff, and we really landed that thing, because you know, Essen was one of his favorite places. It was his retreat, his bolt hole, and we brought him back there in 2012, in full knowledge of what that he was a human being, for God's sakes, you know, and that he shouldn't be deified and mystified and all that other stuff, and that people should know about this. And you know, it's interesting that, you know, that reading went out, and I remember, Dennis, we met in person for the very first time on board that ship, the boat going across the bay for the MAPS conference.
Oh yeah.
And
I was really hoping you were going to say a spaceship, but I guess a boat.
Yeah. we wish
And we,
that'll come.
We saw each other. We found each other standing in front of one another, and we embraced, and we did sort of wordlessly. And then I remember saying to you something like, "Well, you know, you said, you know, the hot potato," and I said, "You know what? It went cold and it got thrown overboard." So it's a message in the bottle. It's out there. And the community's response was incredible. I mean, if you look at the threads around this podcast number 316, it's loving, it's insightful, it's deep. A lot of good things came out of that in the community itself. And
yeah.
So anyway, that's
kind of, you know, I mean, yes, I think the larger community realizes that this was done out of love. This was not an attempt to show Terence in a bad light or to, you know, depict him as anything other than what he was, you know, which was a flawed human being who was, like all of us, just searching and trying to, you know, be as decent as he could and as honest with himself and everyone else. And you know, and that's the thing. When I wrote it, Terence was always pretty open about himself and sharing his conflicts and his doubts. It wasn't like this was a big secret and you know, he must at all costs, you know, appear to be totally under control at all times. I mean, that he wasn't like that. People knew that, you know, he had human traits. And I think that's a large reason why they identified with it so much. I mean, and, you know, and I have gotten no feedback from anybody other than my family, you know, about my book, other than positive feedback and said, you know, I'm impressed with how loving this book is, and that's what it was intended to be. So, you know, again, I just can't second guess the family. I don't know how they think, but it's water under the bridge as far as I'm concerned. And what can you do?
Yeah, that's really too bad that those kind of schisms form, you know, especially, you know, when the person that brought them together in the first place isn't around anymore. And, you know, it's not like anybody had any ill will, it sounds like. It's just one of those things that gets oddly misinterpreted when it goes into the ears of certain human beings. But, I mean, aside from all that...
No,
go ahead.
I mean, that they interpret it through, you know, their filters and the lens of their experiences with Terence. But but you know, the bottom line with all this is I look back and I think, well, how would Terence be? How would he feel about this? And I feel like he would feel just fine. You know, he would be fine with the book and all of this. So really, if he's my toughest critic, I feel like I've made the cut in a certain sense. Mm-hmm. You know, he would understand the spirit in which this book is written. So speaking of book, I probably should plug it here. I mean, I'm on a podcast now.
Please do.
So you know what it is. I don't even have it here, but you know, the Brotherhood of the Screaming Abyss, which is on Amazon. It's on the website of the same page. So, you know, if you're one of the all storage container full of these things, and my pile never seems to shrink. I think these things breed when I'm not paying attention, which is, I wouldn't put it past. Anyway, let's talk about more interesting things.
Yeah. Well, Bruce. I mean, yeah, the two of you, you know, you've both gone very, like I mentioned at the beginning of this thing, very fascinating, unconventional routes in your lives. You know, on one hand, you're highly educated, you guys are both PhDs, but you're also not exactly, you know, towing the line of the academic status quo. Like, you guys are definitely doing your own thing and on your own extremely unique paths. And I think, I think that takes some sort of catalyst, you know, like to get off the well-worn, comfortable path at some point in life takes a catalyst that's undeniable and forces you to really, you know, hack into the weeds and grab your, you know, psychic machete and cover new ground. And I suspect that I might know what that catalyst was for you, Dennis, because you know, we've talked about that experiment at La Charrera. You've written a lot about it. What about you, Bruce? I mean, what in your life, if you can pin it down, was kind of that, you know, transformational catalyst to the person you became?
I think it was a series of things, but one particular moment, this was when I was 9 years old, and I realized that the next month I was going to turn 10. So I thought, you know, the odometer is going to roll and there can be two numbers. This is a big deal. I won't get three numbers for a long time. So I thought, what can I do to sort of honor this transition from 9 to 10? And I was out walking in Kamloops, in North Kamloops, which Dennis knows very well.
Right. My wife is from Kamloops, by the way.
Okay. So
that's how I know.
You probably grew up within blocks of where I used to walk at MacArthur Island.
Right, right.
So I used to walk down in the slough there, and because it was a kind of nature, and I was a loner kid a lot of the time. So I decided to make a pact with myself in the future, my future selves. And I knew I was going to do something to do with like science or technology or something. But I made the following deal. I said, future self, you shall not sort of basically piss on previous self or previous self's decisions. So therefore, I won't get this echo coming back from the future of doubt about what I'm about to do. So I won't get like a future thing, because when you're 9, you kind of, your brain's pretty malleable. So I sort of believed in the malleability of time and intention. And I literally kind of held my hand up and I said, here is the contract. And all my future selves, I could sort of see them very fuzzy, holding this contract all the way down, decades in the future. I said, everybody sign it. And they did. And as soon as that happened, I felt this whole portal open up, this tunnel just opened up into the future where I didn't have to worry about being second guessed for what I did by future selves. And so I could just go for it. So I could go for it without doubt and with real positivity and just basically cast intention forward, like, yes, I am going to work for NASA, and start pulling my imagination into what that looked like. Or yes, I'm going to work on the origin of life, or I'm going to work on virtual worlds. I'm going to live in California. I'm going to set up my own lab, you know, and every time I did that, there was like no resistance into the future. So the future just sort of shot, you know, shimmered through and forward. And that was an almost psychedelic kind of experience when that happened. But it was a great tool, an absolute great tool. And the second thing I decided, I think when I was about 11, that I would always go make decisions based on a sixth sense, like intuition, where if I was walking down the street, I would sense with this barometer whether I should turn left or right. I would get into these modes where I would be completely guided by this kind of ether, this kind of connected smush of ether, rather than like logic or reason. That I wouldn't base my whole life on logic or reason, because I felt that was be really limiting. I wouldn't be able to be guided by external forces that human beings had no clue about. And it's really those kind of two things that allowed me to sort of stand, like when I was 14, I decided I'm going to work on the origin of life for my entire life. This is the most interesting problem that a nerd kid at 14, a nerd kid without a computer, could work on. And I have worked on it and gotten to a point where, you know, as of last Thursday night, presenting at this conference in Texas, presented this grand, total and complete new model for the origin of life to the top scientific minds in the field, you know, in this great Galvez ballroom at the Galveston Hotel. And it worked. You know, this thing has worked. All the pieces came together, and here I am standing. I never took high school chemistry. Here I am proposing a audacious chemical model that they look at and they just, you know, these are Nobelists, but they're looking up at this thing. Oh, you know, here's where a framework, one of them pronounced, this is the only game in town. So it works. This kind of stuff works.
Your origin of life theory was well received.
Yeah,
it the latest iteration at this conference.
It won best poster, and as a result of the best poster. I mean, people.
All right. Yeah, fist bump or whatever we.
It's like an adult. It's like an adult science fair. You won.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, posters. I mean, people outside of academia think, "Well, what's a poster?" But it won best poster, and so I was able to give a plenary talk to the whole conference. And so here's like a new kid in the block at age 53, a postdoc of only 5 years ago, and finally arriving. But I was able to then synthesize this grand theory that I worked out with Dave Diemer at UC Santa Cruz, who's one of the greatest living chemists in lipid chemistry. He's my mentor and my partner. And it's definitely, and this will be for you, Dennis, it's definitely falsifiable.
Good. Well, it's a real theory.
It's a real theory. And it
could be tested and disproven or not.
We have 7 testable predictions in it. And so a couple of the teams have picked them up. So we're going on a world tour this year to go to the labs. I'm building a wiki, and we're going to sign up about 9 or 10 groups to do different parts of the testable predictions in this thing, so we can accelerate it, and everyone can be growing gels in the lab in 5 to 10 years. So these gels are an evolving unit at the base of the roots of the tree of life. So it's exciting. I can hardly believe it, tell you the truth, but it does go back to when I was 9 years old.
Wow, that is wild.
Really cool.
Yeah. And I think some people might view that as really fantastical and wooey, but I think if you think about it from the standpoint of so few people at any point in their life, let alone when they're a young child, really make a strong decision along the lines of, this is what I am going to do. This is my goal. And what they do instead is they just let the currents of life carry them along, and they only make choices when they're forced to, and they get, you know, to some inevitable fork in the road that, you know, really doesn't have that large of an impact on their destiny. But when you really set your mind single-mindedly to something, to an endeavor, and say, yes, this is what I will work on for my entire life, I think that that is an unbelievably powerful, almost like spell you're casting on yourself.
Well, I think this is something that Bruce and I have in common, right? That maybe other people don't, which is, yes, we're PhDs. Yes, we've done the whole academic thing in a sense. I mean, we have, but, you know, we've published papers and all this. Mm-hmm. But academic success or academic recognition was never what drove us, at least for myself. And that's why I'm not a tenured professor anywhere. I don't have grants and all that. I mean, I've had those things, but I don't live for those things. My idea, you know, what drives me is curiosity. And I think that's what drives Bruce. I go after stuff that really interests me, and I don't care. I don't have, I like a lot of academics, I haven't published 500 peer-reviewed papers. I see no reason to. I published maybe 60 in my whole lifetime, but they've been about things that interest me. And I think that's what drives me. The academic thing is just I mean, it's not even relevant, except that you have to, you know, oh, yes, I have a PhD. That means I have credibility. But, you know, what's driven me, and I think what's driven Bruce, is, you know, we both stand outside the box, and, you know, we just go for things that that pique our curiosity.
And, you know, I've just finished reading James Lovelock's new book.
Another example of a completely, totally interdisciplinary person.
And he,
not constrained by, you know, the fact that he was pigeonholed as whatever. He was everything. He was marvelous.
The first half of the book is wonderful reading. It's a little bit trepidatious reading, too, because it's all about the life of an independent gentleman scientist.
Yeah.
Which he was. I mean, he had some contracts and people that he would work for, but he basically worked from his farm and developed those very sensitive gas measurement devices. And he was an independent scientist. He would be at the meetings. He was sociable. He wasn't one of these ones living in a cave. So he gradually could convince his peers of things. And he went on this ship to Antarctica with his instrument, because he couldn't get any funding, but he got free passage on a ship, and he was able to measure the atmosphere and establish the ozone depleting chemical release around Europe, you know, which led to the Montreal Protocol and everything. But he then describes why it's trepidatious. He says that the life of the independent scientist is under threat. I mean, they're virtually extinct, you know, the way that the career scientist is prepared, they're going to be at, you know, the Sloan Center or Harvard, or working in research and grinding away on narrow things, and to have an independent life of thought and science, like, say, a Charles Darwin or an Albert Einstein, these are very rare birds these days. And Dave and I kind of look at each other. Dave is that way. Dave's an independent scientist. His lab is in his basement. We both have affiliation with UC Santa Cruz, but, you know, he set himself up in 1993. The UC system gave him a research professorship, which is not retirement. They gave him a lab and an office on campus, but he's been an independent scientist. So I can go, he has time. He's lots of time. He's not one of these harried PIs. He can spend, we spent 5 years of conversation to come up with this thing at leisure. And I've only recently, because I'm in contact with the whole field, realized how rare that is, how that precious that is.
Yeah, I think this is exactly right. The era of the gentleman scientist who can, by one way or another, they just have wealth. Or I think for Lovelock, it was that he invented the flame ionization detector for gas chromatography. So that was a major invention, and that gave him enough wealth that he could do what he wanted to do. And I really think that something really essential and important about science has been lost, because the independent, you know, maverick scientist is a rarity. And those are the people who make the real contributions. Lovelock, and as you say, Einstein, Darwin. I'd have to put our good friend Alex Shulgin in that. Here's a guy, you know, he could have had all sorts of academic accolades, and he didn't want them because he was driven, you know, by curiosity to investigate an area that was, you know, almost by definition taboo, and that was the whole brain mind issue and you know, the effects of molecular structure on all that. But he was able to actually do that. That would never have been funded, you know, by any government agency. And, you know, I mean, this is a hot button for me. I feel like, you know, science fundamentally should be about the search for truth. It is a tool for understanding nature, you know, and I think this has been seriously lost. You know, big science is just like big medicine or big anything else. I mean, the purpose of science is, you know, prestige and grants and academic positions and, you know, graduate students, post, all this stuff. It's all, I mean, maybe it's not necessary to do good science.
Yeah, it's become bureaucratic
it's an impediment in some ways.
Yeah, yeah, and it's so compartmentalized, and we're losing exactly what you guys are talking about, this multidisciplinary sort of expert that studies for all these years, and then they can distill all of their varied experiences down into a really interesting philosophical worldview. And to me, like, science for the sake of science isn't that interesting. Like, if you're just a really narrow expert in the behavior of, you know, choose your tiny area of discipline, to me that's only interesting in how it fits into the larger picture of the mystery of life and existence in the first place. And you know, that's why I love you guys, because that's the same thing that's driving you. You know, that you're not a PhD to be you know, a tenured professor at Harvard. You're a PhD because it was a means to an end to help you guys understand the world and the human condition better. And I'm the same way, minus the PhD.
Right. I mean, yeah, I think so. I mean, I think, you know, I think it's sad that something, you know, I mean, like so many other disciplines, science is, you know, if you go through the full academic training to become a PhD and to become credentialed, then, you know, the sort of sub agenda of that program is to completely kill your curiosity. You know, so then you're just a technician, and you may understand some very narrow sub discipline, but chances are you don't understand how that relates to the wider picture. You don't even care how it relates to the wider picture. And so I think that something is lost. I think that, you know, standing, being interdisciplinary, standing, you know, straddling disciplines, you know, much lip service is paid to for this, but it's lip service. It's not really encouraged. And you're suspect, you know, you're suspect.
There was an interesting case in history of Louis Alvarez, you know, a physicist who came into geology, you know, this stayed bound field of geology, and basically said, well, if you want to establish if there's been an asteroid impact, look for iridium and a layer all over the planet. And of course, the geologists were, you know, trying to push him out of the field. He's not one of us, and he's coming to our meetings and everything. And then, of course, they looked and they found the iridium. And so somebody did cross disciplines and solve a major problem for the field and open them up, you know, and thank goodness it happens now and then. When I came into Origin of Life in the big way about 6 or 7 years ago, reading all these papers, being mentored by Dave, I realized these are all pigeonholed people. They're all looking at narrow experiments in chemistry and getting these. And Dave was a visionary. Dave said they don't understand how they have to think complexly and horizontally. Mm-hmm. And so that's where we just engaged in thought, visionary thought experiments. And what if Jack Szostak's result over here could map over to so-and-so's result? And then I would go into these reveries, into these multi-hour thought experiments, wearing my headphones on a long flight, listening to really sort of bad techno music and on nothing more than really bad United Airlines coffee. And at altitude, you can really launch, you know, you can launch into full, you know, almost psychedelic type trips. And I've been doing this since I was a kid. I've been doing what I now call endogenous trips. And they're deep. And so they'd go for hours and I would be molecules flowing around in a soup and watch stuff happen. And I would pause these things and come out and draw them in the notebook. Fill pages of notebooks and then go back in and restart. And I just use those weird techniques to, because one day, you know, with reading all the papers, one day it was just going to get delivered and I knew it would arrive. And it was conveniently on a flight to Beijing. So that's how, you know, this kind of weird technique that a career scientist would never use. And then you go back to your colleagues and you cleanse the model and you put your drawings into forms they can understand. And then you try to figure out where the chemistry is, where the viable parts of that vision are. And sure enough, it stood. It had legs and it stood up.
It's so weird, you guys, because I just started reading this book called Alchemy, the Great Work, that I picked up at like a half price books. And there are so many anecdotes in this book about alchemists who would just talk about these, you know, dreamlike epiphanies that they had. And at one point, this was like a serious technique for, you know, developing ideas or having breakthroughs is dreaming or going into these, you know, endogenous trip-like states that you're describing, Bruce. It's something now that would obviously be scoffed at by a lot of people, but it seems like a technique that has a long history, actually.
Well, it does. And actually, it's the root, I think, of scientific creativity. And, you know, it may be scoffed at, but it's scoffed at by the people who don't really get it. I think that, you know, real scientists who think deeply about their subject, I think that they not only understand that that's important, they long for that. They long for, you know, those episodes of reverie that give them real insight in the same way that, you know, a religious person, you know, might long for a mystical experience and hope for it all their lives. And when it comes, it's a revelation. I think scientists, you know, long for that moment of insight, that moment of synthesis and revelation. And, you know, as long as we're on that topic. So speaking of psychedelics, which, you know, sooner or later we're going to get to this, but
yeah, it's going to happen.
You know, but I mean, people say, well, you know, psychedelics can trigger mystical experiences. They can make it easier, right? And some people say, no, that's not a real one. But that's a whole other conversation. Mm. I say if it looks like a psychedelic experience, I don't care whether it's neurochemistry or, you know, divine inspiration. I mean, it's the same thing. But then one thing that I've been interested in for a while, if you look at people like Carrie Mullis, for example, or Crick, who, you know, freely admit that psychedelics were catalytic in the formation of, you know, their ideas. So as Bruce knows, yeah. I'm working
discovering
with retreat center. Yeah, and I would like to, I think that psychedelics are a tremendous tool to, you know, to get people in disciplines together and put them through these experiences in fairly intense, you know, retreat style situations.
Yeah, that would
see
be
what
wild.
Comes out. You know, that would so be cool. Incredible. Yeah,
absolutely.
So I as Bruce knows, I mean, I organize retreats in South America for people who, you know, are there to experience ayahuasca and to have, you know, basically a meaningful spiritual experiences. But I would like to organize retreats that are specialized for, you know, specialists. Like, you know, this week we're having the cosmologists. Next week we're having, the, you know, molecular biologists. And they're all going to get together and take ayahuasca and share ideas. And, you know, I mean, this would be a lot of fun.
Oh, my God. I love
and not
that.
I would expect to learn a lot, you know, myself. I'd like to be the, you know, the fly on the wall sort of present when these people have these experiences and you know, have these revelations, insights that we think the psychedelics can catalyze this.
You so know, I don't there is a precedent for this. If you read the story in the history of the coffee houses of Amsterdam, which were considered to be sort of terrifying places by some, of dens of iniquity. But what was happening there was very strong coffee was being served and caffeine into the European mind for the first time.
Right.
Everything came out of these places. Financial instruments, science, the design of the looker, the first telescope. They were incredible, and they spread to London, and these coffee houses were the whole freaking, you know, Reformation / Renaissance / scientific revolution emerged from the sharing of this common, very powerful drug, actually, for the uninitiated minds.
Yeah, so if coffee can do that, essentially produce, you know, catalyze the Reformation, imagine what would happen if we could get a bunch of people in the right disciplines jacked up on ayahuasca together.
You know, that brings up something I've been kind of curious about is, you know, we know tribal cultures all over the world have a lot of tryptamine-based, traditions. But I've always wondered, have there been hidden ones within the secret societies of Europe and like the medieval and, other times more recent than, you know, more tribal cultures? You know, we know it existed in the Amazon rainforest, but
right. It
must have existed in some capacity in Western Europe. Like, is there any strong evidence for that, that you know of?
Well, that's a good question for Terence, channel Terence.
He would be able to talk about that for the rest of the podcast. But yeah, exactly. I can't tell you a chapter and verse the way Terence could, but some of these alchemical traditions, I think, you know, alchemy is interesting because it was a process, you know, on some level it was, as if you believe Jung, it was a process of, you know, a kind of psychic evolution, you know, individuation, but it was projected onto matter, you know, as a, I mean, so these people had to be hands-on, you know, I mean, they basically had to muck around with stuff in the lab, whether that was a reflection of what they were going through on the psychic level or not. But the upshot was they had to play around with a lot of organic products, plants, animals, or whatever. And their instruments were fairly crude, right? They had distillation, they had alembics, they could, you know, so it came down to a question of, well, what can we, you know, stuff inside this alembic and put the flame to, and what is going to come out of it? Who knows what chemistry might have, you know, because it's not that hard to get spontaneous formation of things like DMT. I mean, it's such a simple molecule.
That is true.
You know, so we don't know. We don't know what, I mean, the focus has been on that the sort of the psychic process of the alchemists. And I have, is anybody really focused on just what was the chemistry that was involved here?
And of course, prior to sort of the alchemist of the 9th century on, there was the tradition of Eleusis, which came out of the mystery schools that were, could have been ordeal poison based. They could have been, of course, based, and this is Hoffman, Wasson, and Ruck in their book about the road to Eleusis, all about, well, it seems as though the Eleusis could have been a combination of an ergot smut, that would have been an LSD analog, a very dangerous concoction, or perhaps Syrian rue potentiating mushrooms, which it seems as though, as Dennis takes a big sip of distilled wine, the wines of antiquity were mixtures. They were blends that included a very small amount of alcohol, frankly, and what they call herbs or plants for the Dionysian festivals and all these other places were blended with a large amount of plant distillations or extracts, and that they put people into such reverie that it seems inconceivable that some of this wasn't psychoactive plants.
Oh, yeah.
And then Eleusis itself, I mean, there's on the frieze in the museum at Eleusis today, there's a guy holding up a platter with 3 mushrooms on it, you know, offering it to somebody else. I mean, it seems as though the mystery at Eleusis and its secret were probably a very powerful psychoactive concoction.
Yeah. Definitely. And what puzzles me, about those friezes and about some of that other iconography, I mean, I'm a layman, okay, but I could look at this and looks like a mushroom to me. I mean, and the people that interpret it say, well, it's flowers. That does not look like a flower. It looks like a mushroom. You know, I mean, where do they get flower out of it? Well, I don't know.
Why would one of the only records about Eleusis in the Greek legal record be in the 4th century BC, a severe penalty levied upon a noble person who had basically made off with the mystery and was holding private parties with it in a villa in Athens and severely punished for this making off with the mystery thing? So, I mean, if you're going to go to all that trouble to make off with something, it better be a very good, party favor. but then of course, there's the counter. Sort of the counterstrike to Eleusis. You know, why would Pauline Christians leaving Constantinople after the Fourth Council of Nicaea, and described by people at the time as zealots and binary thinkers and very unpleasant individuals, they met Alaric on the road to Eleusis, and their goal was to smash the temple because it was the competition to their new system, which was, follow us, we have this book, a lot of words, a mental, male, hierarchical, tax-paying, dues-paying structure that we have built and put into place that allows you to have contact with the ineffable, or God, or whatever, after death, and only if you follow all of our rules, such a deal. And so this is what they did. They paid coin to Alaric, and they smashed the temple to erase that almost 2,000-year tradition of opening people to the light that probably led to the entire modern world. And then these dudes continued on and established their system and ran the whole thing into the ground. I mean, the aqueducts had started to fail, and all of that incredible thing about that antiquity and civilization was, they ran it into the ground, and we went into the so-called Dark Ages and had to wait 1,000 years before people climbed out of that system.
And it's so obviously sorely missing, some sort of actual personal contact with some sort of initiation or transcendent state in the here and now. It's so sorely and obviously missing. And I love, I don't remember for sure which Joseph Campbell book it's from, but he has a great little passage on the idea of, you know, passively experiencing religion or passively experiencing the ineffable by going to church and saying some memorized hymns and expecting that to help you get into contact with the Almighty or a higher power. His whole point is, no, it's absolutely paramount that you do the work personally, or you experience it personally firsthand. And, you know, of course, that feeds into the whole hero's journey thing and doing what you were talking about before, Bruce, with really setting your mind to something and accomplishing that with a clear mind and with purpose, you know. And we live in such an opposite culture. You know, we look to a source of permission for everything. You know, does this get me to God? Does this get me to success? Does this get me to fulfillment? You're constantly looking outside yourself for the answers, when, you know, anybody who's had a experience like this themselves know that it's like, it's right in there. You just need the proper catalyst to make contact with it, and it will. You know, it's funny when we talk about these you know, experiments, like maybe psychedelics could elicit a mystical experience. It's almost like laughable to anyone that's experienced it. You know, like I think back to these, the Harvard psilocybin studies, where they're like, maybe if we give people psilocybin in a church basement, they'll have a mystical experience. They must've been like laughing behind the scenes, because obviously it's going to. And we're still having this conversation now. It's funny.
Sure. I mean, that's true. But I mean, right, it is laughable. Anyone who's had these experiences knows that they can induce a mystical experience. What I think is valuable about, you know, like the recent work that's been done with psilocybin, Roland Griffith's work, and so on, you know, it's kind of like doing an experiment, which often happens in science, where you know what the outcome is going to be. You know what the answer is before you do the experiment, right? But in order to convince your colleagues, in order to validate it scientifically, you have to quantify it. You have to measure it. This is what science likes. It likes measurements. And, you know, so I don't say that that work, in some way, it demonstrates the obvious, but you're putting some quantification around it, and that gives it that sort of air of scientific legitimacy, you know. And if you look at the actual, you know, measurements that they apply, they're kind of trivial. I mean, they're just these highly structured questionnaires, basically, right? Okay, well, if that's what it takes to get, you know, to get your stuff in the New England Journal of Medicine or whatever, then okay, you know, that's. But it's don't you think, Bruce? It's a lot of times these things are, you know, I mean, they're quantified what we already know.
Yeah, and I think when you apply those kinds of methods, you empower, probably completely unfairly, language, not just language, but the languages of questionnaires, which is so limiting and stultifying, to describe something that can barely be encompassed with the greatest poetry. I mean, you can barely, it's outside of language. It's outside of sort of the mundane tools. And here's the irony, though, and that Terence used to point this out in some of his talks, Descartes, you know, the founder, in a sense, of modern science, as you're describing it, supposedly an angel landed on Descartes' shoulder and told him that to master nature, it was through number and measure, you know. So, but it came from this angel, you know, from this entity, that suddenly we got the Cartesian coordinate system and, you know, all those graphs that were crucified on the cross of the graph, you know, all the time. And the greatest insights have to be plotted and crucified on those graphs. So, you know,
kind of ironic.
Okay? It's ironic.
Yeah. Or Newton is another example. I mean, Newton, we think of as the founder of, well, obviously it was Newtonian physics, right? Which was at the time kind of the hardest of the hard sciences. But Newton himself was a complete mystic, a total screwball. I mean, he was an alchemist. He was, you know, he was not in any way a modern scientist in the way that we think of that. I mean, he was a very odd fellow with, you know, many funny ideas, not scientific ideas.
There's a...
He was as much into alchemy as he was into physics.
To the fact that even Albert Einstein and his Gedanken experiments, that if you don't dip your ore into the magic ocean, into the great depths, you know, and you satisfy yourself by piddling around playing dominoes in the dinghy, you know, you're just never going to make the progress, and you're never going to make the big jumps. And what we can do as independent gentlemen scientists is we can dip our oars, you know, deeply, come up, and we can make the proof. Because if we come up with something that is breathtaking, you know, in its scope, and it shifts whole fields, then the proof is in the freaking pudding. Mm-hmm. You've just done that, and you can show a new generation, yes, you need to go back to the magic and the alchemy, and you need to balance yourselves out and get off the Cartesian cross.
It's very funny, because now I have this visual of all these people in a boat, and one guy jumps in the water and comes back in the boat, and he's like, hey, there's an ocean right there. And they're like, well, I don't know. I don't, you know, maybe we should run some experiments and see. It's like, why don't you just jump in there and see it for yourself? And 100% of the time, you're going to agree with me that there's an ocean right there. But on the subject of...
If I may offer another story that goes along with your ocean metaphor, which is Nick Herbert, who lives just around the corner here, and Dennis met him... at our local gym, I think, when he was here. He's a long-bearded quantum physicist. He describes his first psychedelic experience when it was legal in, like, 1961 at Stanford. And he was at Stanford, his first big, heavy launch into this space. And he described it beautifully. He realized that his consciousness had expanded into this enormity. This enormity had unified itself with all consciousness, and it was just this huge space. And he was just, his is this kid from Ohio, from 50s Ohio, a total straight up Catholic kid. And here he is, you know, he's a foot from Stanford experiencing this. And then he described to me how he looked down from this vast space, and he saw this table that had these little cloaked figures on it. And he looked much more closely, and these figures were doing something like playing a football match. They were pushing or kicking this thing, which was this little tent-shaped thing around. There, some of them would push it one way, and others would push it another. And he looked closer, and it said science on it. And he realized, oh, this is how science is moving forward. It's this tiny little tableau of this action, that this sign is moving forward and backward and sort of making progress, but consciousness, or the space he was in, was so huge compared to that. And of course, he came down and did a career in physics. He went on and did that, but it forever changed him and gave him a real perspective shift. This is conscious presence and this unity with this field, and that science. And put it all into nice perspective for him.
Yeah, I think that's.
Go ahead.
Okay, I was just going to say again, that's, you know, the use of the initiation catalyst experience that so few of us get to experience in the current, you know, culture paradigm that we're within, because it allows you to remember that you're non-distinct from the rest of consciousness, or that you're at least connected to it, and that so many of the other structures that we've created and we define ourselves by are really just illusions. And I think, you know, and that's what allows people like you guys to become gentlemen scientists who are, and Isaac Newton as well. I don't know what his catalyzing experience was, but there's a great, I believe it's a Nova special on him that does get pretty deep into his, you know, esoteric proclivities and how, yeah, he was a professor at Oxford, but he spent all of his time in the basement doing alchemy and reading these like texts and trying to decode the Bible. And all of his, like, his students wouldn't show up to class because they thought he was such a weirdo. He would oftentimes go into the classroom and no one would be there. And then he would just go back down to the basement and continue his experiments. You know, it's like once you've tasted the pudding, so to speak, it's like everything else is just a detail, and you want to figure out how to build your life around diving deeper into that proverbial ocean we were talking about before.
Yeah, I think that this would be, you know, I mean, this would be something that most scientists or people in any discipline, but especially scientists, could benefit. Sort of some catalytic experience that reminds them, you know, dude, you really don't know very much, right? Don't forget how little you know, and there, don't get arrogant because your ignorance, you know, far outstrips your knowledge, and it will always be so. So, you know, just keep that in mind as you explore, you know, this little tiny part of the universe that is your discipline or your specialty, you know, because yeah, it's cool as far as it goes, but it's a tiny part of the whole picture, and people lose sight of that. I think psychedelics or other revelatory experiences really forcefully remind people of that, you know. And I think that something that is missing from scientific education that I think is regrettable is very few scientists ever take a course in philosophy of science. Mm-hmm. You know, I was an anthropology, philosophy, and biology major, not necessarily in that order as an undergraduate, but as a philosophy major, I read a lot of philosophy of science, and it was very useful because it forced me to think about what science was, what is this thing that we're trying to do. And that's where the whole issue about, yes, it's basically a tool for asking questions of nature. And if they're properly asked, you can actually get some verifiable answers out. I think that most scientists never think of that. You know, they just don't, it's just not in there. They never actually think about the process of science. And, you know, they're so busy doing science according to the constraints of their discipline that they don't think about it. And so as a result, they can't really, you know, I mean, they're technicians, not thinkers. I mean, they can run the machines, they can interpret the graphs, they can generate the data. Do they ever pause to step back, you know, and twist up a bomber and look at their data and say, what does this mean? Mm-hmm. You know, that is rare. Yeah. You know, and that's what people like Bruce and his friend do. You know, I mean, they have the tools for the discipline. They understand the chemistry, the physics, and all this, but they give themselves permission to step back from it and look at it from a revelatory space. And they see connections that most people don't see because they never look for them.
And we, just as an example of that, you have to get out of your office. You know, you have to get out of your lab. So Dave and I, last July, we went to the Pilbara in Western Australia
with
with other scientists. And we slept in swags, which are bags on the desert floor of the Pilbara, one of the most remote places on the planet. And we, with shaggy, you know, Pleistocene camels walking past us at night. And you know, drank a lot of boxed wine, and which is, you're with geologists. So, and the greatest new tool for geology in the last 30 years is the invention of boxed wine. It won't break in the back of a ute. You know, right. That's the greatest innovation in field geology. I called this last week. I said to Dave, this was our voyage of the Beagle, you know, that Darwin took on this ship. And we went to the field. We snorkeled with stromatolites, living modern relatives of the oldest fossils on the planet in this cold saline pool in Shark Bay. And then we drove 2,000 kilometers to meet their ancestors, who were 3.5 billion years old, in this craton, in this styrofoam block of continental mass that contains the it's like a ship of the arc of life on Earth. It has the oldest fossils on the planet in these rock formations, and you touch them and you run your fingers up and down the ridges that were formed in an ancient, you know, pool. 3.5 billion years ago, when the sky was orange and there was no oxygen and there were impactors coming in, and it was an alien toxic world, and it was only there, only standing on that this sort of domical hill, that I looked down and I saw this crust, which was what's called a microbial mat or desert mat, and I took out my water bottle and I poured my water onto it, and it came to life. It became spongy, just like the surfaces of the living stromatolites on the coast. And I realized this is the missing link between the microbial community that dominated the planet for 3 billion years and its ancestor, which was this really small kind of gel of protocells in the fluctuating pool. And it was only by going to the field, only by being basically spoken to by the landscape, that insight could happen. There is no other way to do it. And in our entire field of origin of life, virtually none of the chemists will go out into nature to hydrothermal systems, or they will not. And so the gentleman scientist of old, the Charles Darwin, took their world voyage, you know, to do that. And we don't do that anymore.
Yeah, so, I have to tell you, I have to riff off that if I could. I have a funny, interesting tale to tell about my supervisor at the University of Hawaii when I was studying for my master's degree. Sandy Siegel was his name, and he was an environmental geochemist and toxicologist. He was studying extreme environments, which is one reason he lived in Hawaii, because he was fascinated by things that live in volcanic vents and this kind of stuff. And his wife was also a brilliant microbiologist. And talk about out-of-the-box thinkers, you know. I mean, I was so blessed to have Dr. Siegel as my supervisor, because he was a walking out-of-the-box thinker, a truly creative scientist. And I mean, I write about him in the book and with great affection, because I remember him with great affection. But I remember that he and Barbara, his wife, they got a lot of grants from NASA because of the extreme environment connection, and they would simulate extraterrestrial environments in their lab, and then they would see how terrestrial organisms would survive in these incredibly, you know, simulated, like, Jupiter and outer planet environment. And it turns out many things do just fine. You know, organisms do. But anyway, this one thing, they got a grant to go to the Antarctic to study the volcano there, and to study the dry valleys, right? And the Antarctic dry valleys. And there's a lake there that never freezes, even though it gets way, way below zero, because it is so briny that it never freezes. And this place is where, you know, they did experiments with, like, the Martian rovers and things like that, because they assumed that nothing could possibly live here, right? And so it's as close as they could get to a Martian environment. They would put these things down there. So they got a grant for some reason to go down there, and I think mostly to study the volcano. And, you know, and so Barbara, you know, who is rather a portly, you know, middle-aged, you know, scientist, she gets there and she walks out to the edge of this lake, and you know, she looks down and like there's some pink stuff there, and she bends over, she, well, what's this? You know, and she puts it, you know, she takes it back to the lab and they look at it, and it turns out like it's some algae that nobody's ever identified that's colonized the edge of this lake, you know. And so they bring all these samples back to their lab in Hawaii, and they and no one has ever been able to cultivate anything off these samples. There's, you know, you put them in culture dishes, nothing happens, you know. So Sandy has the brilliant idea, well, why don't we do it at, you know, 0 degrees? And let's see what happens. So they incubate everything at 0 degrees, and stuff is flowering all over the place. You know, nobody ever thought to do that. Everything was incubated at 21 degrees. Well, of course, these things are cold adapted organisms. You know, 21 degrees is lethal temperature for them. So just as an example.
And last week, NASA's chief scientist for Mars exploration, he presented these incredible pictures from the Curiosity rover, and he showed it to us for the first time at the meeting. He said, "Here, watch this." And the frames are going, and they're approaching Mount Sharp. I mean, they're climbing. They're going to climb this incredible mountain. I mean, thousands of feet.
Yeah.
In the next several years, he said, "Look at where we are." And we're going through it frame by frame. And he said, "This is a saline lake. We have identified we just went on a lake bottom, and now we're coming up. And here's the edge of the lake that was here." And for us, Origin of Life people, it's just amazing that they're finding springs and lakes, and that we're finding another planet that had the similar conditions as in those back in that period. We're driving rovers right through a lake shore.
Mm-hmm.
We live in an interesting times, you know.
And wouldn't you just love to be able to get some samples from there? You
know? Yeah.
There's just got to be something living.
That would be wild. And I think that points to this bigger, you know, sea change in our understanding of outer space, you know, whether we're talking about, you know, microbes on the International Space Station or water on Mars, or changing our idea about what space is. You know, we used to think of it as these disparate entities that are totally separate and not connected by anything. But now, you know, the most modern cutting edge view of space is like this interconnected information system looking thing that looks like a brain dendrite or like whatever. Like, I just watched this amazing video that I tagged you in, Bruce, about the Lanikea supercluster that is the new kind of paradigm of, you know, the part of cluster of galaxies that our galaxy belongs to. And it looks like a lifelike system. It really, really does. And I do have a question. When we see that, when we see that kind of web-like structure, what are we looking at there, Bruce or Dennis? Are, like, what is it, dark matter, or what is it that's connecting parts those of outer things. Space?
I think Bruce can feel this one.
Well, I'm not an astronomer or astrophysicist, but I'm a fan of all of this work. And at Christmas, I went down. Gail and I were back east. We have a friend named Carter Emmert, who is the director of astrovisualization at the Hayden Planetarium and at the American Museum of Natural History. And they were premiering for the first time this all new projection system. And 10 years ago, Galen and I were down with Carter lying on a rug that he rolled out over the Zeiss door. And he said, "Watch this." And I took video of this. He said, "I'm putting up for the first time Sloan Sky Survey in real time on our dome. So we can sort of travel." And there was patchwork going everywhere. patchwork and the blue marble earth. It was real time rendering, not a movie. And last Christmas, I mean, just a month ago, there we were again, looking at the most incredible data, this cone going from the Northern Hemisphere and the cone going from the Southern Hemisphere into the Sloan sky surveys and the other sky surveys. And you could just take a joystick and you could power your way through out of the solar system, exoplanets and so other solar systems Kepler has found, and then just keep going. And it was just mind-blowing. And I did this in my usual nine-year-old self. I did an experiment when I was witnessing this. I said, you know what? I had a flash, which was, if there's a Carter Emmert on some alien world, you know, billions of light years away, some other galaxy, who snuck in after security has gone home to the alien observatory and is joysticking their way through this sheet ball of galaxies or these dendritic forms of galaxies, for an instant, they're going to be having in their alien mind the same structure as I'm looking at. So what if I just laid back, and I did this experiment, I laid back and I took a patch of what Carter showed me, made a mental model of it, and I started strobing it. I started saying, okay, let's just move it piece by piece by piece, and until there was this flashpoint in which there was this recognition. It was almost like eyes blinking. Now, maybe this was my fantasy, but I did this very repetitive movement of rotating the structure around such that it would be seen from another angle, and it would be the same thing that some other mind might see. Mm-hmm. You know, communication, for God's sakes. Mm-hmm. And it came to a flash point at a certain place, and it was visible and palpable. You know, so maybe this is the kind of, and we can't communicate over such distances, but if our minds are almost like resonators, you know, they're quantum mechanical devices, and if our minds properly tuned, where maybe the elevated mind is a mind in which it's all the electron pathways, all the neural pathways are more potentiated so that electrons sort of get smeared out. If they could become a transceiver, and then you could resonate with patterns in other places, because the tuned in, turned on mind, you trace all the pathways through your neurons, those pathways outnumber the countable particles in the cosmos. You know, it's a very big chunk of ramified matter. So if there is such a thing as Bell's non-locality, if there is such a thing that when you're in that state and you see the face of God or an alien spacecraft or something so large it's outside your experience, perhaps what you are actually doing is resonating with the real thing. Mm-hmm. It is the face of God. It is the totality. It is the alien spacecraft, because your mind is a beautiful instrument that can both transmit and receive back through your filters. You still have your filters. But maybe that's what we achieve when we get into these elevated states.
Yeah, I love that. I love that interpretation. And this is something I talk about all the time, but that image of the brain scan of the brain that's on psilocybin, where it has all these crazy connections that don't normally form in the brain, it really looks a whole lot like you are boosting the capabilities and the perception that you have to a very cohesive level that we don't normally have. I mean, there's a very obvious feeling when you're in that state that there's a revealed sense. I mean, that you're seeing some sort of extra dimensional perception that you don't normally have. And that probably sounds 100% crazy to everyone that hasn't experienced it, and 100% obvious to people that have. I mean, it really does feel that way. It really does feel like you are witnessing something extra, like
although it's interesting, it does feel that way, but there's a couple of kind of interesting things coming out of some of this psilocybin neuroimaging and research. On the one hand, there are this group that is saying, well, everything is hyperconnected, and you see these hyperconnectivity networks that they can measure. I don't know exactly what the technique is, but it comes out of neuroimaging. So you get that. And then you have
another group that is saying, well, you know, our findings don't match what we expected. In other words, what we found was that psilocybin impairs blood flow, impairs communication between certain parts of the brain, you know, and so it's almost like it suppresses it. So how do you reconcile that? And well, you know, one possible interpretation is that, you know, the brain is like almost all other systems, it's regulated by feedback loops, right? And certain parts of the brain will inhibit or stimulate other parts, and it keeps it all kind of regulated and flowing smoothly within certain parameters, right? Mm-hmm. So if you disrupt that, then each of these different, the cortex, the amygdala, the temporal lobes, all these different parts, they don't have those constraints anymore based on these global feedback, repressive mechanisms, regulating mechanisms. So they're kind of free to just do their own thing independently, and you get the effect from that. You know, it's like the governor is not governing anymore. Mm-hmm. So that's, I don't know, that's
so go back to our favorite ghost Terence. Do you believe, this is a question for Dennis, that Terence's vast consumption of science fiction, 50s science fiction, predilected him to the filters to when he had experiences that he would see very science fiction-y things, you know, machine elves from Dimension X and stuff like that. That was a patterning on to him that predisposed him to interpret the experience that way.
Well, yeah, I mean, not just Terence, you know, I mean, I think we were all infected by that, you know, in a certain way, a whole generation. So it's very hard to, you know, I mean, every nerdy kid who grew up in the 50s, people like you and Terence and me and all these people that were, you know, excited by science, and we're all science fiction addicts, basically. And it twisted our worldview, not in a bad way. I mean, maybe that's the wrong term. It certainly affected our worldview, and probably in a good way. But it gave us a framework, you know, for interpreting these odd experiences. I mean, that's kind of interesting that in the 60s, you know, we had this framework of science fiction, and so that the experience of psychedelics fit well into that. You know, before that, in indigenous cultures, they didn't really have that framework. So for them, it was all about spirits, and mm-hmm. you know, that was their model. Mm-hmm. But for us, we were, you know, unless we were deeply religious, and most of us weren't, most of us by the age of 12, we pretty much rejected all that. You know, so, but we had this framework of science fiction. So these things happened, and we didn't see angels. We didn't see spirits. We saw aliens. Right? Same thing.
Yeah. I mean, and I think that's something that we do throughout the ages, is we only have the most relevant modern language and paradigms to compare things to. Like, you know, that's why people are now visited by gray aliens and not succubi or some kind of other weird monster. You know, we can only describe things in the most modern way we know of. And I see the same thing happening in, you know, the way we think about the universe. Like, now we talk about the universe as being more like a simulation than anything else. Well, why is that? Because a simulation is the most advanced piece of language we can use to describe that phenomenon. And I think that's just going to continue to change as we develop our understanding and our language and our technology. It's going to, lo and behold, look, it's more like this.
Yeah, we're going to apply whatever framework, whatever conceptual framework is the most advanced that we can as we understand it. But it's always good then to remind ourselves, well, it probably, you know, really isn't like that. I mean,
this is a limit. This is a limited model too. They're all limited.
I'd like to point out to my friends that get all excited about Ray Kurzweil's pronouncements about singularities, and of course Terence was on this bandwagon too, that in 50 years people are going to find it incredibly laughable that basically something like Microsoft Office was going to become sentient, you know. Because if we look back at previous generations, you know, in the 1930s with H.G. Wells, you know, War of the Worlds and the Orson Welles broadcast, I mean, all those creatures were basically, you know, basic electronic piston-driven things. And Frankenstein was a 19th century creation that was conceived to arise out of gear and mesh and pressure vessels. And we think they didn't, how foolish they were that they didn't understand the complexities of biology and neurology and whatnot to propose that you could build such a thing from such ridiculous components. You know, it's like Spock designing the radio and when they're trapped in 1930s Earth, you know, and he's trying to make a radio to get them beamed out of Dillinger's Earth. You know, that was a great episode.
I guess I missed that one.
Spock had to wear a beanie cap like this to cover his pointy ears when right. in the soup kitchen, you know? And eventually, of course, the ship puts heat onto the Chicago of the time and knocks everybody down with a beam, you know, and then the gangsters are really respectful of the Enterprise. Yeah, they just brought out their heat and they leveled the city. But all that said, I think, you know, I have this debate all the time, and the magnitude of how a cell works, the complexity of how actual cell biology works, when you start studying it, it becomes, you know, to coin a term, it becomes a psychedelic opening, because your mind goes and goes and goes, and you realize, oh my God, this is how we work. This is how the ribosome makes proteins, and this is how stuff is floating around, and that's just one cell, and there's trillions of cells, and your mind just explodes because it's so inconceivably huge as a machine that it works. And when you open to the true power of what is there, all of our technology falls by the wayside. Every time now I look at, I can't even go to computer conferences anymore because people are still, they're looking at autonomous cars, you know, been looking at autonomous cars for 70 years. Mm-hmm. And our technology is so pitiful. So I remember staying up most of one night with Terence in Hawaii, talking to him about the difference between a microprocessor-based system, a serial processor doing its thing, and a glass of water, you know, a piece of ocean, and say, look at the properties, look how different these are. Our technology can't, all the supercomputers in the world cannot keep up with a simulation of this glass of water. If you put them together, they can't. They can't do a predictive simulation of that. Right. That's so much more powerful than this. We're reading way too much into technology. It's just pathetically underpowered. And by the dawn, the breaking of the dawn over the volcano on Hawaii, Terence turned to me and said, well, I hope they don't take it all so literally.
Right.
Well, we're not going to have intelligence uploading or downloading into software systems and autonomous. You know, we didn't. And it's simply from people just reading way too much into what humans have, what the monkeys have done compared to what the monkeys are. You know, what we are and the world that we come from is so much more mind-blowingly, awesomely amazing than the stuff we've been able to do with our hands so far.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so this goes back to what we were talking about at the beginning. It's useful to step back and remind ourselves how little we know.
Absolutely.
You know, I mean, yeah. We know what we think is a lot, but it's really a small fraction. And so it's good to remind ourselves of that. And you can respond to that in several ways. In one way, you can be depressed. You know, you can say, well, gosh, we're never really going to understand very much at all, and we're not going to understand how this thing works, you know, and that would depress some people. I, on the other hand, it doesn't depress me, because I sort of think, well, you have to accept your humility. But on the other hand, look at how much more marvelous and miraculous that it is, much more than you can possibly imagine. So that, to me, that's kind of cool. That's stimulating. And I can say, well, yeah, I probably will only always, inevitably, I'll understand a small part, but there's plenty to learn. There's no excuse for boredom, and you can try and stretch your mind as far as it will stretch and just have fun understanding things.
Yeah, good point, Dennis. You know, if you turn off the mind for a moment and you say, we're not understanding, and then suddenly this sea of incredibleness pours through you, and you finally get released from the prison of your own desire to understand in your own little mental model, and suddenly you're set loose on this beautiful ocean, and you can sort of appreciate the ocean and your existence on it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, at the same time, you just have to accept that, it's a lot more than any one person or one species will comprehend.
Yeah. And for me, it's always like, I'm torn, like I said earlier, about my view on science and what we know, because, you know, just before this, I was watching The Cosmos, and I love that show for many reasons. And it also frustrates me for the reason that it just doesn't seem like it's wrapped in mystery. It's not paying enough reverence to mystery. It's being told from the standpoint, like, we know all this stuff, and we know how little we are and how inconsequential we are to the whole universe. And look at how little of a part of the history of the world you are. And I look at it from an inverse standpoint, where everything that's happened up till now has led to this supremely special, rare, crazy moment of all these 7 billion sentient beings running around on the world trying to figure out what the fuck is happening, you know? And that's beautiful. And that's more important to me than all the billions of years that preceded that, as far as I know, at least in my very limited piece of knowledge. So I love hearing it from guys like you that really do the work and do know a lot. And that's what you default to, is we don't know a lot. And I respect you guys extra for that.
Well,
I think you have to be able to admit that, or you're not being honest with yourself, mm-hmm. you know.
One moment, very special moment in the Amazon, and this wasn't with you, Dennis, but it could have easily been. I was basically patted on the nape of the neck and said, okay, kid, you know, monkey, get up, stop thinking, and start moving. So I got up and like turned my brain off, and I just started moving, and I was just swept away by the energy. And its message to me was, you cannot know this thing. You must become it.
Mm-hmm.
So, and it was beautiful. And then everything was in unity. Everything was spinning. Everything was dancing and moving. It was one incredible thing that could only be felt and becoming it. And there was no container, no mental model that it could be ever stuffed into. So for that moment, it was wonderful guidance from the teach. You know, teach said, okay, stop thinking, get up and start moving.
Right, right. Yeah.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Well, yeah. It's we have been going for a while, gentlemen. I don't want to take up too much of your evenings, but I definitely want to give you guys an opportunity to talk about what you're involved in right now and what you're working on before we go our separate ways.
Yeah, this is the kind of conversation, you know, we could go all night probably, but
oh yeah,
your viewers wouldn't tolerate it. You know, so yeah, I suppose there's no lack of things to talk about, you know, especially with Bruce. We've got you and I, Bruce, we have a few things we've got to follow up offline, whole lot of stuff going on.
What
how do you want to wrap up?
Well, I know, What about like the Hefter Research Institute? What are you guys working on there presently?
You know, right now we've gotten to the point where our research has paid off in a sense, or been validated enough in a sense, that we've reached a point where we have to look at how are we going to overcome, you know, the regulatory burdens, the regulatory hurdles that keep these substances from getting into clinical use. You know, so we're not regulatory people. We don't even want to do politics, but we're forced to confront politics and regulatory issues and FDA approval and all of these things that, you know, inevitably, I mean, and this is actually a sign that we've succeeded in a lot of our goals. I mean, we've brought it to the point where, yes, now we have to, you know, have serious conversations with policy specialists. How do we move this into actual medical practice so that the discoveries we've made, the work we've done, actually benefit people and can be integrated into psychotherapy or hospice care or whatever the right place for it is. So that's an interesting experience, you know. And as we get into this, I see that my colleagues are getting, you know, maybe even more conservative than they already were, because nobody wants to, you know, I don't know what, no, nobody wants to create any kind of public relations stir or anything. We just want to kind of quietly move ahead with it. At the same time, the work is going on and, you know, it's all good. I mean, we're going to see where that evolves right now, but we're, you know, I can't really disclose too much, and I don't really, you know, I don't really, I'm not really quiet. I can't even tell you. It's not that I know so much about it, but within the Hefter, there's efforts to try to, you know, get psilocybin changed to a different schedule so that other clinicians can work with it. And that's just where the work has brought us to this point. I mean, it's just logical. So it's not that exciting, it's boring, but
that's so hugely important, the rescheduling. I mean, the fact that, you can go away for decades for the substance is just absolutely ludicrous that we're still living in that world, but we are, you know.
That's going to change. That is changing slowly. And, you know, we don't know what the time frame is, but and it's also a question of how is this going to come into society in a way that people have more access to it. And it looks like with psilocybin, it's probably going to be initially, it's going to be in hospice care. I mean, that is actually an opening for the use of psilocybin, you know, that wouldn't alarm too many people. And it would be a tremendous boon to medicine, you know, because, you know, one of the big gaps in medicine and biomedicine as it's practiced, you know, we don't do death well, you know. I mean, medicine is all about keeping people alive. And when you come to the inevitable point where, no, this person is going to die, then medicine kind of throws up their hands. And it's ugly. We have no compassionate way to deal with death, you know, and then we call the priests in or whatever, but, and they have their thing, but, you know, so psilocybin and the use in hospice, I think really opens a whole pathway potentially to medicine actually beginning to, you know, effectively deal with death, which is always there. It's always the elephant in the room. It's gonna happen. Nobody gets out of this alive so far, right?
Unless
we're all gonna be there sooner or later.
Yeah, unless you're Ray Kurzweil. He's holding on to it.
Well, good luck.
Exactly. But yeah.
I don't think so.
Yeah, we're on so many weird horizons right now, whether it's technological or, you know, pharmacological and societal and all the repercussions that would come along with that. Where this is.
I mean, I think his idea of the singularity in that sense is true. So many trends are coming together, and it's, you know, and some are not so good, and some will be our salvation. I think we're kind of looking at a race, you know, we're going through a bottleneck now. Are we going to get through it into some sort of golden age, or is it all going to collapse into chaos?
We're one meteor away from starting all over again.
Yeah.
Speaking of which,
like any good drama or show or movie, it's all going to come down to the car chase.
To the car chase, yes.
I like that.
Exactly. Yeah.
But speaking of the meteor analogy, Mr. Damer, I know to give you a chance to talk about what you're working on, what's new with your projects. Is there anything new with like the Shepherd or anything like that?
Well, Shepherd was a high school project. I found my drawings from 1978 about asteroid capture and resource utilization, and it was another dream when I was young. And what that has happened to that now is, you know, the previous show listeners might know, I did a TEDx talk in April, and I did four more talks. We did a talk to the senior aerospace engineers in June. And I had another talk in Santa Cruz in a big theater, a full-length talk where I throw pictures of Isambard Kingdom Brunel up on screen and then Elon Musk and say, is this the Brunel of the 21st century? A single individual who revolutionized transportation, right? With the steam engine and the locomotive and the steamship. And the speaker that was just before me as an electric car operating system company, came up that I will introduce you to Elon, and because
that will work out. But
yeah,
but please finish. It was crashing. Michael, right? I'm sorry,
Michael. I see this. This.
Yeah. Stuff.
I got this Sony voice recorder as a backup audio of just in case.
Awesome
technology. You can't trust it.
Great.
You
know? Yeah. That's yeah. True. Yeah. But I do want to hear the end of your story though. So did you were about to be introduced to Elon Musk. Did it happen?
So the email, the CFO of Solar City did introduce me to Elon, but that probably meant that Elon looked at the email and watched the TEDx talk. And beyond that, I don't know. But what that might mean sometime this year, especially when space.com's big story is going to come out, because they did interviews last year and we did a huge amount of graphics for them. And they said they're going to do the story this year. And I suggested the following, which is, you know, the movie The Martian. Mm-hmm. The Martian is a good testament to how not to go to Mars.
Mm-hmm.
whereas Shepherd is the proper way to do a Mars exploration architecture, as opposed to the disaster of the dumb way that they show in the movie, which is landing all their hardware in one location and having no return, nothing in orbit for a returning fueling station. And just, they had to abort the whole thing and leave Matt Damon behind. So perhaps space.com's story will be slanted that way. Oh, now you saw the Martian. Now let's show you a proper solar system sustainable architecture. So that would be a dream. So that if that comes out, that'll come back to Elon, and perhaps that will trigger him to bring the three of us, the three inventors, down to SpaceX to pitch the cycle of low Earth orbit demonstrators we need to fly to prove this thing.
That would be incredible.
Well,
if you need anybody without
incredible, I mean,
I was going to say, if you need anybody without any technical expertise, just to be an intellectual gentleman on your team, please give me a call after you get the Tesla money or the SpaceX money, and I'd be happy to do that for you.
Well, if you do get an audience with Elon, I want an introduction.
Me too.
Because I got a project for him that I can't really share in this podcast, but I'll tell you later what it is.
All right.
Yeah, and then maybe at a future time we can talk about it.
That would be
this,
cool.
This was the epiphany of my latest retreat at Wokatika. This is what I walked away with.
And, it was a good one.
It was a total download, man, but it's, I can't talk about it because they'll say, you know, well, he's getting manic again, you know. we have to adjust his medication. I don't want to, you know, but I'll tell you later.
Or as Terence used to say, I'll say, well, they better put him on a shorter leash.
Exactly. Right.
Well, gentlemen, I think that's a great note to end it on, even though I do wish I could hear that story. But thank you guys very much for doing this. This was really, really cool. Exactly what I was hoping it would be. Is there anything you want to tell people about, like websites or anything like that?
Always a pleasure, Michael. Let me see what's going on.
I think I'd love to send people to the Levity Zone, my own podcast. Just Google Levity Zone. But one thing for you, Michael, you look kind of like a younger and less pugnacious Joe Rogan. So what you need behind you to get that kind of pugnacious effect is you need a brick wall. And pictures of what was it he's got on his wall? He's got like a fighter, and he's got what was his name? The rock and roll singers.
Jimi Hendrix. Yeah.
Yeah, he's got Jimi Hendrix behind him all the time.
Now I'll take that comparison. I'm a big fan of his show.
Your spirit guides behind you on camera.
Yeah, I'm working on upgrading my whole setting, but I'm still in the process.
Okay, well, you got this in the can, so keep us posted.
Absolutely.
And maybe by the time it comes out, maybe my plan for world domination, which I must say is still in a very nascent form, but it'll be further developed and then we can talk about it publicly.
I would love to hear it. Yeah. Clue me in, please. That would be, I'm curious. You got me. Okay. Got me curious.
All right. Good.
Call me anytime, Dennis.
Yeah, I will, Bruce. I'll be out in the Bay Area in May. So
I'll be here.
Okay. All right, gentlemen. Thanks so much.
Thank you very much.
It was a pleasure.
Yep, yeah. Absolutely. Right. Have a great evening. Thank you, guys.
Okay.
Symbiosis complete.
A thousand thanks for hanging out for this wonderful mind meld, my friends. I truly enjoyed this one. I am grateful for the opportunity to speak to both the great Dr. Dennis McKenna and Dr. Bruce Damer. These guys are legends to me. I hugely respect what they stand for, what they've done, and everything they are working on. Please go check out Brotherhood of the Screaming Abyss, Dennis McKenna's tremendous book. Check out Dr. Bruce Damer's TED Talks on both outer space-based novelty and the origin of life in the universe. How can you not be fascinated by that stuff? And check out the Levity Zone podcast and the Psychedelic Salon podcast, both of which Bruce Damer is involved with. If you would like to support this thing, of course, you can head to ThirdEyeDrops.com and trickle a little altruism our way via a donation or through our Amazon portal. And if you do shop through our portal, why not bookmark that thing so you can just get at it easily next time? And please, please support this thing by giving us a subscription and a review on iTunes or your service of choice, and come hang out with your new pal, Michael Phillip, on whatever social media vessel you desire. All the best to you, my dear friends, and I will talk to you next week. with another tremendous guest. I'll just say that it is a conversation that will be filled with quantum arch weirdness of many kinds.
Thank you for listening.